nature.
Did you miss this week's Downton Abbey? Find full-length episodes on pbssocal.org.
Each year, Hollywood manages to deliver a handful of performances so memorable, you crave to know more about the people behind them.
Did you shave your legs?
I waxed my legs.
Please join us for the Hollywood Reporter Roundtables, The Actors, with Josh Brolin, Jake Gyllenhaal, Michael B. Jordan, Jared Leto, Matthew McConaughey, and Forrest Whitaker.
Saturday at 10 on PBS SoCal.
You're watching PBS SoCal. PBS for Greater Los Angeles.
PBS SoCal supporters include the following.
Stem cells are showing great promise for the treatment of disease and injury. At UC Irvine, innovations in stem cell research are rapidly moving potential therapies from the lab to the patient.
From the depths of an Irish peat bog emerges a mangled body from the distant past.
He's got a trachea. Behind it would be maybe esophagus,
but that's a rib.
It's one of hundreds of other eerily well-preserved cadavers recovered from bogs across Europe. Ancient people from a dark and mysterious era, victims of unimaginable violence.
He was hanged.
He was decapitated and cut in half.
Centuries later, these mysterious remains raise compelling questions.
You stand face to face with a dead man from a period so far, far away.
Who were they?
This is a man who did not engage in any manual labor.
And why were they buried in the bogs?
Normal people were burned, cremated, and put in an urn. So this is highly unusual.
The bog body, in my view, is a king.
Now, an international team of experts will subject this latest find to a modern scientific investigation.
This is a young person's spine.
Following the forensic evidence and historical record back in time to the world of the Celts. A mystical society ruled by warrior kings, queens, and druid priests, practitioners of a macabre and brutal ritual.
It's far more than just sending somebody over to the next world.
He's drowned, he's burnt, and in other references, he's stabbed.
Why were they slaughtered? Were they despised outcasts or revered sacrifices? This is a 4,000-year-old cold case, Ghosts of Murdered Kings. Right now, on Nova.
Major funding for Nova is provided by the following. The David H. Koch Fund for Science, supporting Nova and promoting public understanding of science. And the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by PBS viewers like you. Thank you.
A bog in Ireland's Midlands. Wet, spongy ground composed of peat. A fossil fuel commonly burned in Irish homes and power stations. A heavy equipment operator spots something sticking out of the bog in front of him. When he stops to investigate, he's confronted with a grisly sight. It's a human body, flattened and distorted. The brutalized corpse of a murder victim. Within hours, a team of specialists responds. They excavate the partial body of a man, hoping to find clues about his identity and how he ended up in the bog. From the color and condition of his leathery skin, it's clear that this person died centuries, if not millennia, ago. And he's not the only one. In recent years, many other ancient victims have been found in Irish peat bogs, joining hundreds of other bodies found in bogs scattered across northwestern Europe. The bodies of these mysterious time travelers have captivated the public. And clues preserved in their flesh hint at a dark era of strange, gruesome practices. One of the most provocative of these cadavers is on display in the town of Silkeborg in Denmark. Tolland Man. He was unearthed in 1950 by peat cutters working in a bog outside the town. Carbon dating revealed that he was around 2,300 years old, the victim of a violent death.
During excavation, it became very clear very quickly that he was hanged, because he still had a noose around his neck very tightly. And you can also see the furrows here, a groove around the neck at a very high position that indicates that he was hanged.
Tolland Man's body was almost perfectly preserved by the bog, and his still vivid features offer archaeologists a rare chance to study pre-Christian Europeans.
Look here. If you see his face, it's so fantastic, and you see his wrinkles, you see his stubbled chin, and so it's almost like a CV, but we can't read it.
The body of another brutally executed man was found just 11 miles from Tolland Man. Paulina Singh is an archaeologist and curator of Mosgaard Museum, home to Denmark's iconic Grovel Man. He too is over 2,300 years old and remarkably preserved by the bog.
You stand face to face with a dead man from a period so far, far away, and he looks like you. And his nails are very well preserved, his fingertips. You can still see the small lines in them. You could see his beard when he was found. You could see the pores in his skin. It's fantastic.
Grovel Man's remains also preserve a record of his mortal injuries.
He had a deep cut from one ear to another.
Other European bog bodies show similar signs of violence. Holdemose woman, also of Denmark, had cuts on her right arm, legs, and feet, and may have been strangled. The midsection of one of the Weerdinge men from the Netherlands had been torn open and his guts pulled out. Ida girl, also from the Netherlands, was strangled and stabbed to death. These well-preserved examples show evidence of extreme violence. Why were these people killed so brutally? And will this most recent find in Ireland also show signs of violence? The forensic investigation begins when the body arrives at the National Museum of Ireland in Dublin. The team of scientists and archaeologists here is led by Ned Kelly.
This is a very, very, very important find. And it's a big responsibility to make sure that, you know, we get the maximum information from this body. We owe it to the man lying on the table.
There may be ribs.
Ned has spent a lifetime studying ancient Irish history and archaeology. Both he and his team have investigated previous Irish bog bodies. Most notably, Clonie Cavan Man, killed by three axe wounds that split his skull. And Old Crockin Man, who suffered a stab wound to his chest and was decapitated. All of the previous bog bodies have been named for the towns where they were discovered. Accordingly, Ned names this find after the nearby town of Cashel. Now he and the team must decipher the confusing mass of bone and soft tissue to solve the mystery of Cashel Man. To understand who he was and why he died.
The body was in a very unusual position, and it took quite a while to work out what was what.
The head is missing, destroyed by the peat harvester. The torso is badly damaged as well. And it's been compressed and misshapen by centuries in the bog.
I mean, that looks like the front face of the vertebrae.
It does, doesn't it?
We've definitely got a good bit of tissue. There's an organ there.
It's hard to differentiate the tissues, but they find what looks like a lung.
There's all the ribs there. And that looks as if that could well be the heart.
As with any criminal investigation, the first order of business is to determine the cause of death. State pathologist Marie Cassidy will conduct her inquiry as she would in the case of a modern death. To begin with, she visits the scene of the crime. She speaks to Jason Phelan, the milling machine operator who came across the body in Cashel Bog.
I turned at the right time and looked on the left-hand side and I saw this piece. It was probably maybe 6 inches
right.
Triangular.
And was it sticking up above the surface then?
It was penetrating maybe this height just above the surface in triangular shape. And I just went over and kind of caught like this gently and gave it a little bit of a tug. And when I gave it a tug, two legs came up gently out of the bog.
Marie also examines the peat milling machine. Its sharp spinning blades were responsible for slicing into the body's chest.
What it means is that there is a tearing motion, and that would account for the damage that you see on the body as it was photographed at the scene, because the surface skin had gone and you're now looking into the guts, if you like, of the body.
Examination will help to assess which injuries were caused by a 21st century milling machine and which could have been caused by a violent attack thousands of years ago. At this early stage of the investigation, every clue is important.
The more information you have, the better the outcome, the better your opinion, the better the information that you can give somebody. So it's the same with the bog bodies. All of these experts get together and eventually a story will come out.
But thousands of years after death, how detailed will that story be? They need the help of modern medical technology. In the lab, the team subjects Cashel Man's body to a CT scan, a 3D x-ray that will allow them to peer into the body to identify bone and soft tissue, and perhaps shed light on who Cashel Man really was.
This is a young person's spine.
How young do you think?
Well, probably 20 to 25.
The images from the CT scan help the team to understand the orientation of Cashel Man's skeleton. They can clearly see that his legs are drawn up to his chest and his hands clasped around them. He is lying on his right side, but his head and left arm are missing, most likely destroyed by the peat harvester. The CT scan also reveals two dramatic ruptures to Cashel Man's spine, where the vertebrae have been moved severely out of alignment.
That's right, and you can see there where the cord would be compromised there.
This is so bad.
I'm just thinking in terms of trauma.
Just about the middle of the chest, it looks as if almost the spine has been cracked open.
Could this injury be the cause of death? A crippling blow to the back?
And you can see a nice V-shape appearance. So that indicates major trauma.
The team consults with forensic anthropologist Niels Linnerup. He has studied other bog bodies and has determined that what look like injuries are sometimes caused long after death by something he calls bog trauma.
There are some substances in the bog which actually helps preserving the bog body. At the same time, however, there are also other substances, acidic substances, which start degrading some of the tissues. For instance, the bones come completely bendable. They get basically like wet cardboard.
Linnerup believes that the most likely explanation is that the powerful acids in the bog softened the ligaments holding Cashel Man's spine together. And the slowly increasing pressure of the growing bog pushed the vertebrae out of alignment. So what seemed at first to be a mortal injury most likely took place centuries after Cashelman died. But examining the CT scan reveals something else, which could only have happened near the time of death. A clean break to his right arm that shows no signs of healing. To Marie Cassidy, it's the first clear evidence that Cashelman was the victim of some kind of violent attack.
There's good evidence that this person was injured at and around the time of death. We can see the bones very clearly. And this bone here, the bone that runs down towards your little finger, that's actually about midway, it's just been literally halved in two. So that indicates major trauma. So amazing, so we can actually even, we're starting to recreate an incident that he could have been involved in.
That's right there.
Yeah, I can see that.
And they find another clue. A long, thin cut across his back.
That was revealed by excavation.
Yeah.
It was down in the peat. So I don't see how that particular cut could possibly have been caused by the milling machine.
Oh, I agree. You know, I agree. It's remote from it.
No, it's definitely not the milling machine then. Something else.
The cut suggests a slash with a very sharp blade. That evidence helps clarify Cashelman's broken arm, which now looks to Marie like a defensive injury.
I mean, your injury to your arm looks like a true injury.
Yeah.
And if that's a true injury, then you have to think of a mechanism. Yeah. And the most likely mechanism I would have thought those days is you're in the middle of a fight with somebody wielding something.
Yeah.
And therefore, it's quite likely then that the death is trauma.
But why? Why were Cashelman and the other Bog victims attacked so violently? What do we know about the time and place in which they lived and died? 2,000 years ago, Ireland and Northern Europe were home to the Celts, a culture of fierce pagan warriors. Little is known of them. They kept no records. But from ancient Rome, there are written accounts of savage tribes encountered as the expanding empire's armies came into conflict with the people of Western Europe. Around 100 AD, the Roman writer Tacitus described Celtic villages as fashioned with no regard to pleasing the eye, and Celts who ravage, slaughter, and seize under false pretenses. To the Romans, there was a word for people like these. Barbarians.
It goes back to a classical term, sort of a barbaroi, meaning people who, in a sense, speak in languages which are incomprehensible to the classical world, bar, bar, bar. So that's the origin of it. But basically, it had come to mean, you know, people who are not like us, people who are different from us in the classical world, because they're not civilized, they don't write things down, they don't have organized laws, and they don't have organized structures, and so they're sort of almost not quite human.
Though Rome conquered much of Europe, the Romans never managed to invade Ireland. And today, historians caution that many of these Roman accounts are little more than propaganda, meant to demonize an unvanquished foe.
You have to look at the Romans as the imperialists that they were. The Roman worldview was, of course, that the Roman way of doing things was the best way, and indeed the only worthwhile way of doing business.
But there's another source of information about the Celts which provides another perspective.
In Ireland, we have a relatively huge volume of very early literary and annalistic material, mythological material, that we can trawl through to see if it provides any information on the context of these bodies.
These ancient myths and heroic tales were part of an oral tradition, passed from one generation to the next, until written down in the Middle Ages by Christian monks. Their manuscripts paint a vivid picture of the pre-Christian Irish past. They describe the Celts as an ancient pagan society, ruled by kings, queens, and druid priests. They tell of struggles between rival warriors and gods and goddesses, who could be fickle and unpredictable, prone to meddling in human affairs and requiring bloody rites to appease them. These ancient stories lead Ned to believe that the violent deaths of two of Ireland's most famous bog bodies, Old Crockin Man, who was stabbed in the heart, and Clonie Cavan Man, whose head was split open, were actually human sacrifices. Victims that belonged to a long, grim roll call of men, women, and children across Northwest Europe. Some may have been criminals or prisoners. Most were brutally murdered. All buried in the bog. Radiocarbon dating of most of the hundreds of previously discovered bodies places their dates of death between 500 BC and 200 AD, during Europe's Iron Age. A time when ancient craftsmen had mastered iron smelting to make tools and weapons. The team fully expects that Cashel Man too will prove to be an Iron Age body from the same period.
I don't know.
So when they receive the radiocarbon dating report, they are stunned. This body is older, much older. Cashel Man died 4,000 years ago, more than 1,500 years before the other Irish bog bodies, during the pre-Celtic Bronze Age. It's a complete surprise.
It's much earlier than we anticipated. That's very, very exciting. It's probably the earliest fleshed bog body in Europe.
Cashel Man lived at a time before Europeans had learned to smelt iron, before Tutankhamun ruled in Egypt, making Cashel Man the oldest fleshed bog body in the world. To Ned, it is tantalizing evidence that depositing victims of violence like this in bogs was a practice that began many centuries earlier than previously thought. To try to understand what was behind these strange burials, the team turns its attention to Cashel Man's grave, to the bog itself. The bog is a complex ecosystem with a long history, and the subject of extensive study by wetland archaeologist Ben Geary.
Bogs are incredible places. They have an enormously long history. They've been part of the landscape for millennia.
Bogs develop where groundwater is highly acidic. Here, the ground is waterlogged and oxygen poor. The conditions preserve dead organic plant matter, which accumulates to form a carbon-rich, spongy material called peat. The same conditions that preserve the peat also preserve the corpses, and even give them their strangely darkened color.
When we see bog bodies, obviously the skin is often looks like it's been heavily tanned, like someone who spent far too long in one of these tanning booths, and that's a result of the humic acid which we have in bog water. And you can probably see that if we squeeze it, you see the brown water coming out.
The bogs act like time capsules, and by cutting into the peat, Geary can expose preserved layers going back millennia.
We've got around about 2,500 years of peat accumulation in the section here. This is sphagnum moss, and you can see for a deposit that's maybe, you know, perhaps 1,000-1,500 years old, and the preservation is remarkable.
As dead matter accumulates, the bog slowly expands, growing around 1 millimeter a year. A single meter of peat can act as a time capsule, preserving a 1,000-year record of plant life, ancient artifacts, and bodies.
Within bogs, we essentially have, you know, we have this record, we have this memory of the past, the memory of past environments, past peoples, and past landscapes. And we just don't have that in any other environment on the earth.
Details of those environments are captured in peat down to the microscopic level. Archaeologist Ellen O'Carroll takes core samples that hold clues about the ancient landscape. Her sample includes the area where Cashel Man was discovered, but also looks deeper, further back in time.
Cashel Man was found at the top of the peat bog, and he dates to 2000 BC. So this is a record of the 700 years before Cashel Man was deposited in the bog.
By examining the contents of the core, she begins to piece together a picture of the ancient landscape and how it developed over the centuries.
At the bottom of this core, we have evidence for a marginal forest where alder trees were growing. You can see the wood remains in here, and you can see the reeds just poking out here. As you get up further, you can see your areophorum, or your bog cotton, which is the white kind of cotton you see growing on the bogs. So what you can't see with the naked eye, and what I analysed back in the lab as well, is your pollen. You can fit 30 pollen grains on the top of a pin. So they're so tiny, you need the microscope to identify them.
Ellen's analysis of the pollen grains will reveal what sort of vegetation was flourishing around the time of Cashel Man's death.
So there's a hazel pollen grain.
The type of species she detects may indicate the scale of human activity in the area where Cashel Man was buried.
That looks like an ash pollen grain, Fraxinus.
Ash and birch quickly grow after mature forest has been cleared. Pollen from these two species dominate the samples, indicating both ash and birch were more prevalent than they would be in an undisturbed wild forest.
The presence of ash indicates that humans were around the area. They were cutting down the forest. Cashel Man died within the vicinity of a community that was quite vibrant.
Further analysis of the peat core reveals more evidence of human activity. Microscopic traces of charcoal indicating fires were burnt in the area. Confirmation that Cashel Man was buried close to a human settlement. But what would this community have been like? Billy McFlynn studies Bronze Age archaeology by recreating the technology of that vanished world.
What I try to do is look at the originals and imagine how they would have been done, and using similar types of technology to what they had in the past.
Billy demonstrates the smelting method that pre-Celtic Bronze Age artisans used to create everyday objects. In this case, a small axe head.
What we're going to do is take these bits of bronze and put them in the crucible here and heat up the whole thing. The idea is that the metal will melt and turn to liquid.
To make a high-quality casting, the bronze needs to be heated to at least 2,000 degrees. To achieve this temperature, much hotter than the temperature of an open flame, prehistoric bronzesmiths probably used bellows to force air into an enclosed furnace. Once the bronze is molten, he pours it into a clay mold, then cools it by quenching in water. Finally, he breaks it open to expose the solidified metal.
It'll clean up and polish very nicely, and I'll be able to hammer a sharp edge onto it. What really comes across is how refined they had their skills. And sure, their technology is at a more basic level than ours. What they could do with what were essentially more limited conditions than what we have now was astonishing.
Bronze Age technology and culture in Europe provided a foundation for the Iron Age Celtic civilization that succeeded it. From Ireland and Britain in the west to Poland and the Black Sea in the east, hundreds of diverse tribes flourished.
The knowledge we have is of an immensely sophisticated group of people. We know of hierarchies of people, so political leaders, religious leaders, and other people. So in fact, a highly stratified society, but one without writing, and so it's largely silent and very difficult to get at.
There would have been trading centres where you would have had, you know, something approaching an urban economy as well. So the idea of international trade and commerce and exchange were not foreign concepts. But the backbone of the economy was probably agricultural production.
To these Iron Age farmers, the land was sacred. Among the hundreds of gods and goddesses mentioned by Roman authors and depicted in Celtic artwork, female deities play a leading role, bringing both fertility and abundance, but also threatening drought and destruction if displeased with humans. Might these beliefs hold a clue to the motive behind the Bog Body murders? In the town of Derryville, just 30 miles from Cashel Bog, a large excavation is providing intriguing new clues to Iron Age weather patterns. Scientists have long known that in times of heavy rainfall, these bogs come to life and grow. But during times of drought, the mix of plants and other organisms changes. In preserving a record of life in the bog, the peat also preserves a record of environmental change. One of the clues to understanding what conditions were like thousands of years ago are these microscopic single-celled organisms known as testate amoebae.
Testates live on the bog surface, and we know from modern studies of testate amoeba what moisture preferences different species have. So we can use knowledge of the present as a key to the past.
Some species of testate amoebae prefer wet conditions, while others flourish when conditions are dry. Ben Geary exploits this difference to describe thousands of years of climate history.
As bogs grow and change over time, depending on how wet or dry they are, of course, this will be reflected by the composition of the communities of testates that are living in the peat.
Under the microscope, Ben identifies different species of fossilized amoebae that lived thousands of years ago.
So this is another species of testate. It's called Archela discoides. This is an indicator of generally rather wet conditions. This is Hylasphenia subflava. This is an indicator of comparatively dry conditions.
For 20 years, scientists have been collecting peat samples from a variety of bogs. Now, by cataloging the population density of each testate species in those samples, Ben creates a detailed record of the ancient Irish climate as it changed over time.
There's been a huge amount of work done on different bogs, different sites in Ireland and indeed in Northwest Europe, attempting to track changes in bog surface wetness really over the last 5,000 years or so, or maybe even longer.
The data describes periods of bad weather and difficult growing conditions that sometimes lasted decades or longer.
We tend to see that there is increasing evidence for a climatic shift, a shift probably to a wetter and a colder environment around about the Bronze Age, Iron Age transition, so very, very broadly around the time that we do get increasing evidence, you know, of bog bodies appearing in wetlands.
The most extreme shift towards a colder climate, according to Ben's research, appears in the data around 850 BC, when rainfall increased and temperatures sharply dropped. It was one of the most significant climatic events since the Ice Age, and it lasted hundreds of years. But how would ancient people who worshipped a goddess of fertility have dealt with what could have been long periods of failing crops and hard times? At the Derryville site, archaeologists have uncovered another ancient link to the bogs. It's a network of finely crafted tracks which once created a path across the spongy ground. Henry Chapman has been studying these handcrafted walkways.
Now this one is beautiful. It's a wickerwork hurdle, so you can see it extending quite some way along here.
Some Iron Age trackways in Europe may have been used as roads for taking cattle safely over bogland, but not all of them served that function. None of the trackways uncovered at Derryville traverse the entire bog. Instead, each ends right where the marsh was at its wettest. To some, this suggests that the wet, marshy area was a destination rather than an obstacle. But for what purpose? One clue could be the wealth of valuable objects found buried in boglands and dating from all periods. The scale and locations of these hoards lead historians to believe that they are offerings placed in the bog to appease ancient deities. Archaeologists call them votive offerings.
A votive offering is simply a gift that is presented by people to a god or a goddess in return for some expected favor. It's an offering which has been made on behalf of the community.
One such offering, excavated from an Irish bog, was a large container of butter, a valuable commodity 2,000 years ago. Ned Kelly believes it was an offering to the goddess of fertility.
We're clearly dealing with material that has been deposited for a reason. And that reason, I believe, was the protection of the cattle herds and to ensure continued supply of milk by the herds and proper food resources.
Thousands of other ancient artifacts have been excavated from Irish bogs. Feasting cups, cauldrons, engraved millstones for grinding grain. And these are also thought to be offerings to the goddess of fertility. Sacrifices like these hint at the sacred nature of the boglands of Iron Age Europe. This evidence suggests the trackways at Derryville were mainly built for ritual.
If it doesn't make sense in any sort of practical sort of world, then it's likely to be something which is a different sort of practical, you know, something about belief systems. It's allowing them to ask for things, to ask for help, or to ask for thanks. Those sorts of events which happen, you know, either at times of conflict or at times when they require a good harvest. It's those sorts of events which are what these things are probably about.
Trackways have allowed Celtic tribes to access the bogs to commune with their deities. But why deposit a body in the bog? Archaeology in Ireland and in Northwest Europe has shown that typically these people did not bury their dead.
Normal people were burned, cremated, and put in an urn or a pot or just a shallow pit. So this is highly unusual.
Did the tribes of Ireland and Europe intend the bodies themselves as offerings? Were men, women, and children murdered and then left in the bog to appease the gods? Was that Tollant Man's fate?
Why was he hanged? Was he a criminal? The way that he was put to rest in the bog, like lying in a sleeping position on the one side, somebody must have closed his eyes and his mouth because he don't look like this peaceful if you're just hanged. So I personally think that he was sacrificed to a god or a goddess.
The Celtic bog bodies point to the widespread practice of ritual murder. Ned Kelly believes clues to this theory might be found on one of Europe's most precious ancient artifacts, the Gundestrup cauldron.
This is a rather elaborate cauldron made of silver, which was found in a bog at Gundestrup in Denmark.
It dates to 200 BC. The same period as many of the bog bodies. Panels ringing the cauldron depict Iron Age deities. One image shows a ritual performed in honor of the goddess of fertility.
There is a figure who is holding a victim over a cauldron. This victim is either being drowned in the cauldron or perhaps he's had his throat cut. It's an image of ritual killing. And there are other images relating to ritual killing on this object. We have one image of a male deity holding aloft two human victims, who in turn are holding aloft two pigs who are also to be sacrificed. And on an image before me here, which shows the goddess lying at her breast, are a human victim and a pig who have been sacrificed. So there are a number of references on this object to human sacrifice.
For Ned Kelly, the Gundestrup cauldron offers clear evidence of human sacrifice. And this, for him, helps explain the mystery of the bog bodies.
This cauldron shows the context within which those killings may have taken place in ancient Ireland. And the context is ritual sacrifice.
Were the bog victims ritually killed by their own people? Sacrifices to the goddess of fertility? Were they the target of a macabre practice believed to be associated with ritual murder? A practice called overkill. Ned has led forensic investigations into two other mutilated bog bodies. And he believes that in Ireland, overkill was a real phenomenon. First, Clonie Cavan Man.
The first blow appears to be a blow in the face. Broke his nose, and he was then set upon around the head with an axe.
Also, Old Crockin Man. Forensic science revealed he too was the victim of a gruesome murder.
He died as a result of a stab wound to his heart. He was decapitated and cut in half, and the other parts of the body were disposed of elsewhere. There's far more done to this body than needed to be done to kill the man.
Ned believes the extensive injuries to these bodies are evidence of overkill, and that this extreme violence served an important purpose within the ritual.
Very often that sacrifice is done with far more violence than is necessary actually to kill, as though the act itself conveys sacredness. The more violent, the more complex the killing, in a way the more valuable the gift is. It's far more than just sending somebody over to the next world. It is highly ritualized, so it's spectacle, it's theater. It's a collective act involving collective responsibility.
The theory of overkill was developed following the Danish bog body discoveries in the 1950s. Today, it is hotly debated by experts as they continue to study the bodies. But even if there is a similarity in the way the Danish and Irish victims died, there is an important distinction between them in how they lived.
This is some of his last meal, Carpelman's last meal. And it has been eaten more than 2,000 years ago. And they found out that there were seeds of 66 different herbs. It's not the best, it's animal food or poor man's food. And it's interesting because many of the other Danish bog bodies has the same last meal inside when they found them.
Grobbelman had the diet of a peasant. But what about Cashelman, who died at least 1,500 years earlier? The team is eager to know what Cashelman's final meal was. Was it also a poor man's mix of seed and grains? To find out, they first need to find his stomach. Professor Cassidy begins with a fingertip search in his internal organs, but finds the stomach has entirely decomposed. Other Irish bog bodies have offered richer clues about social status. Forensic archaeologist Andrew Wilson analyzed hair samples taken from Clonie Cavan Man.
Hair is quite a unique resource. It locks both physical information and biochemical information.
Chemical traces for the food Clonie Cavan Man ate in the months before his death made its way into his hair as it grew.
So we can tell something about the chemical information that perhaps tells us about that person's diet.
Tests of Clonie Cavan Man's hair, along with an analysis of the contents of Old Crockin Man's stomach, indicate that both victims enjoyed a diet rich in protein, an indicator that they were men of high social status. And there are other telltale signs. The hair on Clonie Cavan's head offers a surprising piece of evidence about who this Celtic man was and how he lived. At the University of York, Dr. Joanne Fletcher has been looking at Clonie Cavan's hairstyle.
The more we were looking at the hair, the more we realised there was no actual knotwork in there, there was no plaiting, no actual intricate styling of the hair itself. And yet the hair appeared to have been set up on top of the head in a rather tall arrangement.
To hold his hair in place, Clonie Cavan Man was using some kind of Iron Age hair gel.
When we did the analysis on the material from Clonie Cavan's hair, we found out it was essentially a vegetable plant oil mixed with a resin.
Analysis showed that the resin came from a pine tree, but from a species not native to Ireland. It's resin from a tree that only grew in southern France and Spain. Apparently, Clonie Cavan was wealthy enough to be able to afford imported beauty products from abroad. And there's further evidence of how Clonie Cavan styled his hair. Fragments of a hair tie.
So it's clear that this so-called hair tie, the thing that had been used to keep the style in place, had actually been attached, wrapped around the hair to secure it on top or towards the back of the head in some fashion.
Fletcher offers a theory as to why Clonie Cavan wore his hair on the top of his head.
We know he was only 5'2", so the fact that he'd been going to such lengths to increase his height, it's sort of a twist on the old, you know, platform boots for short men, you know. Why bother with that when you can sort of pile the hair up, fix it in place, and this adds to the height?
Fletcher's theory that Clonie Cavan enjoyed elevated status does have historical precedence. Roman author Tacitus wrote about the Celts and described a particular hairstyle, the Swabian knot. The style can be seen on a German bog body known as Osterby Man. According to Tacitus, elaborate hairstyles gave Celtic warriors a larger stature on the battlefield and also indicated social status. From his hairstyle, imported hair products, and rich diet, Clonie Cavan appears to be a member of the Celtic upper class. But why, of all people, would high-born men have been chosen for sacrifice? Searching through some of the country's oldest literary records, Ned has found a clue. The Annals of the Four Masters was compiled by Christian monks in the 1630s, but Kelly believes it reflects much earlier Irish traditions. One account describes the excessive violence used to murder a king who is said to have ruled Ireland 1,500 years ago.
Now, you have a reference here to the death of the High King of Ireland, Murkatach Mac Uirc.
According to the annals, the king was drowned in a vat of wine after being burned on the summit of the hill.
The king is killed in a number of ways. He's drowned, he's burnt, and in other references, he's stabbed as well. This is referred to as the triple killing of kings.
The triple killing of kings is a common theme in the Irish annals. Some scholars doubt the relevance of these medieval tales to the Iron or Bronze Ages, but Ned believes that stories of royal inaugurations may also hold the key to understanding the motive for putting a king to death. One account of a medieval ceremony describes how the new king was symbolically wedded to the land over which he was to rule, in this case, the province of Connacht.
And while Feile Mac A. Mac Owen had married the province of Connacht, in the manner remembered by the old men and recorded in the old books. And this was the most splendid kingship marriage ever celebrated in Connacht down to that day.
This symbolic marriage of the king to the land itself made the king directly responsible for the success of the harvest and came with potentially fatal consequences.
If it fails, he will be held accountable for failing to keep the goddess in a benevolent frame of mind, and he will be replaced through his ritual killing.
Ned believes that telltale signs on old Kraken Man's body suggest he too was high status.
His hands have been perfectly preserved. He has no calluses whatever on his hands. This is a man who did not engage in any manual labor. He had an armlet. I believe that that armlet signifies that he was a person of rank.
Ned believes that Cashel Man, with his defensive arm wound and slash along the back, is another sacrificial victim.
My conclusions are that the body of Cashel Man is that of an early Bronze Age king who has been ritually killed because he has been deemed to have been a failure in his kingship.
Ned has a final clue that he believes could indicate where Cashel Man was slaughtered and why he was buried in Cashel Bog. It's a medieval map. Like the annals, it may reflect traditions from centuries earlier. In this case, the boundaries of Ireland's ancient kingdoms and the inauguration hills on which tribal kings were crowned. The map shows that Cashel Man and Old Kraken Man, although separated by centuries, were both buried in bogs at the foot of Inauguration Hills. Ned believes this is a sign both men were deposed kings, each buried in the shadow of the hilltop on which they had once been crowned. To find out more, he's exploring the hill overlooking where Cashel Man was unearthed. The map shows that the hill and the bog mark the boundary of an ancient tribal kingdom, part of modern-day County Leash.
We're just here. Crook Locker, I think. The bog is over here, on this boundary. You can see there's a boundary running around here.
The hill's wide, flat summit overlooking the kingdom made it a place of assembly for ancient tribes performing kingship ceremonies. Ned believes they came here both to crown their kings and to remove them in murderous rituals, including Cashel Man.
He, in my view, is a king who was probably inaugurated here on this hilltop. And when his kingship failed, he was ritually killed, and he's buried down there in the boundary surrounding this inauguration hill. It just cannot be coincidental.
Since the discovery of Tolland Man and Grobble Man in the 1950s, experts have searched for clues to explain the bog body phenomenon. But despite the best efforts of archaeologists, forensic scientists, and historians, the motives behind these violent acts will never be known for certain. The only record left behind are the hundreds of mysterious bodies unearthed in Europe's wetlands where they had lain for so long, marking eternity, buried in the bog.
The exploration continues online, where you can watch this and other NOVA programs. Find out about a discovery in Florida of America's own bog people, preserved for over 8,000 years. And how do corpses become mummies? There are more ways than you might think. Watch original video shorts, explore in-depth reporting, and dive into interactives. Find us at pbs.org/NOVA. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter. Labyrinth of Roman ruins. A chamber of mass death.
Tombs packed full of bodies layered on top of one another. Multiple people dying within a very short space of time.
But what killed them? And why were they buried this way?
This science represents the best chance we have of finding out.
Solving the Roman catacomb mystery. Next time on NOVA.
Major funding for NOVA is provided by the David H. Koch Fund for Science, supporting NOVA and promoting public understanding of science, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by PBS viewers like you. Thank you.
is Stephen Hawking. Come with me and I will tell you the story of how I became who I am.
He would spend a lot of time looking at the stars.
Oh, he was great fun. He was eccentric. We were going to defy the disease. We were going to challenge the future.
Here, time stops. You've reached the true beginning of everything.
This Nova program is available on DVD. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS. Nova is also available for download on iTunes.
Certainly not.
Why don't we have a party? Welcome to Downton.
To order, visit Shop PBS. Also available on iTunes.
The winter you've been waiting for is on PBS.
You must choose either death. Life.
All the drama.
There's going to be changes at Downton.
It's getting harder to say no.
The adventure.
The waves are breaking all around us.
And the spectacle of nature.
We're going to show how special these animals are.
Come in from the cold to the one place that can take you any place.
What if we could unlock every mystery?
We're at the beginning of a revolution.
That's a huge discovery.
That's never been done before. Ever. Anywhere.
That's not confirmed.
No one feeds our curiosity like PBS. Give to your PBS station so future generations can keep asking, what if?
PBS SoCal supporters include the following.
This is the Campbell's new Honda Pilot. Here we go. The same car that will take five very athletic kids and one cellist to a great many extracurriculars. With the Bluetooth that will get them ready for wins and also a few losses. And the rear view camera that will help keep an eye on just about everything.
Come on, George.
Start something special with the Pilot at your local Honda dealer.
No, she has no idea.
No one told her, right?
Hi.
My name is Stephen Hawking. Come with me, and I will tell you the story of how I became who I am.
We were going to defy the disease. We were going to challenge the future.
Coming up next on PBS SoCal. Tonight on PBS SoCal.
My granddaughter is named June Elizabeth, but I call her Junebug. My hope is to teach her about kindness and about the love of animals and nature. I want Junebug to have the same opportunities I had by watching PBS. My husband and I feel so strongly about our PBS station that we've included them in our estate plan. PBS is part of our values, and we want to pass it on to the next generation.
75%. That's the percentage of California high school students who graduate. The other 25% do not. One in four students.